Macmillan Audio presents Spirit Tech, the brave new world of consciousness hacking and enlightenment engineering. Written by Wesley J. Wildman, Ph.D. and Kate J. Stockley, Ph.D. Read by Roger Wayne. Foreword. Technology and spirituality are two of the strongest forces shaping the landscape of human culture and consciousness. Yet we rarely speak of them in the same breath. Over the coming decade, that may radically change as we witness a revolution in the way we practice and access spirituality. Already, millions of people use meditation apps. Department stores sell brain training wearables that help us quiet our minds. Virtual reality can take us on a psychedelic or technodelic journey. An advanced brain stimulation is on the cusp of facilitating states which usually require thousands of hours of meditation. This brave new world of spirit tech naturally brings up a host of questions, concerns, and profound possibilities. Are these new advances shortcuts? Are they missing some vital part of the spiritual or religious journey we typically traverse with traditional methods? Is there something fundamentally different between a traditional method, such as meditating on a cushion, and using an app or wearable? Are the spiritual experiences attained through something like brain stimulation authentic? What are the implications of a profound mystical experience being as easily accessible as our cell phones? These are just a small sampling of the questions and issues at this emerging intersection, with implications that reach into the very depths of what it means to be human and the future of humanity. Yet remarkably, Spirit Tech is the first significant text devoted to discussing them, and I can't overemphasize its importance. Wesley and Kate have dedicated their academic careers to exploring spirituality and religion as it intersects with modern culture. In Spirit Tech, they have beautifully written about this cross-disciplinary topic, touching neuroscience, engineering, consciousness, religion, and ethics in a style that is both rigorous and accessible to the non-academic. This text will help us to navigate these new, wild, and hopefully wonderful tools in a way that maximizes the benefit to ourselves and humanity. This is important, as the increasing power of technology combined with the fundamental nature of spirituality opens the door for both existential dangers and profound possibilities. It was these possibilities that captured my imagination 10 years ago when I began my own journey to bridge these seemingly separate worlds. Inspired by the first line of the United Nations UNESCO Constitution, that since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. I applied my engineering skills to change the world from the inside out by creating modern tools to heal and awaken the minds and hearts of humanity. When I began that journey, it was quite lonely. In academia, meditation had already become a popular research topic. But the idea of applying that scientific understanding toward the development of meditation technologies was mostly unheard of. The companies focused in this area were often fringe and plagued by pseudoscientific or New Age beliefs. Not content with the existing landscape, I started a global community and nonprofit called Consciousness Hacking. Later, I developed and taught three courses at Stanford University, co-founded conferences such as the Transformative Technology Conference and Awaken Future Summit, and developed a tech platform for human connection, which you can read about in Chapter 4, Engineering Togetherness. I'd like to share a few of my observations and learnings accumulated over the years, which I hope will add useful perspective as you listen to this book. People often feel that technology is somehow fundamentally different from or at odds with spirituality. This is a well-founded concern. And I'll be the first to acknowledge that our modern tech landscape feels anything but spiritual. However, for millennia, the spiritual landscape has produced its own technologies. Though not silicon-based, the history of spiritual practice and religion is defined by invention and innovation. Meditation techniques, temples, prayer, ritual, these are all tools and methods designed to more reliably access our spiritual nature. If we take the definition of technology to be the skills, methods, and processes used to achieve goals, then are these not technologies? We might even say that the creation of spiritual technologies is one of the defining qualities of modern humans. Yet, many of us are still uncomfortable with the idea of modern technology playing a part in our spiritual lives. We feel that something is dissonant about our devices. We enjoy their usefulness, but at a cost. What is that dissonance? After traveling the world and speaking with thousands of people about their experience, while simultaneously diving deeply into my own journey toward creating tools for connection, I've boiled it down to a simple observation. Modern technology is out of harmony with life's natural rhythms because we, as modern humans, are out of harmony. We are disconnected from our planet, stripping it for its resources so we can create and consume more. We are disconnected from each other, practically enslaving ourselves both as workers building the gadgets we love and as consumers saving up for the latest upgrade. Most significantly, we are disconnected from ourselves, hungry for distraction from the anxiety and emptiness buried within. In essence, we are disconnected from our spiritual nature, and our resistance to modern tech as a spiritual tool is because in it we sense the spiritual disconnect embedded in its design. But technology can be anything, limited only by imagination and the laws of physics. It is the amplification of its driving intention. If we overlook the possibility that technology can be skillful, can actually meet us where we're at, can be kind, gentle, and loving, then we are missing out on one of the most important capacities that humanity has, namely, our ability to innovate on the means of spiritual growth. What happens if we stifle our human development while our technological power grows at an exponential rate? What happens when you give the power of the universe to a child who is selfish, heartless, and afraid? We could also ask the opposite question. What happens when you give the power of the universe to a mind that is clear, a heart that is open, and a soul that is wise? In the words of Alan Watts, technology is destructive only in the hands of people who do not realize that they are one and the same process as the universe. The incredible power of technology has been irrevocably unleashed. The question now is, what do we do with it? If its valence is indeed an extension of the intention wielding it, then there is an incredible opportunity. My hope is that we build our future from a place of wisdom, love, and the desire to uplift humanity, and thus create the spiritual technologies that will push humanity toward its greatest potential. I'm grateful to this book and its authors for opening our minds, posing the questions, and inspiring the sense of possibility that will guide us in that direction. Mikey Siegel, January 2021. Preface. This book is about the intensifying interaction between technology and spirituality. Specifically, brain-based technologies designed to trigger, enhance, accelerate, modify, or measure spiritual experience. Some people find this territory wonderfully exciting, while for others, it is alarming. It's certainly a brave new world out there, and having accurate information can help navigate it successfully. That's our overall aim in this book. We'll explain how the various technologies work, share information from the experts, innovators, and pioneers of each technology, and relate our conversations with the people who are already using these technologies. Along the way, we'll address the big philosophical, psychological, and ethical questions that spirit tech elicits. Questions of authenticity, meaning, safety, and social responsibility. But first, I want to tell you about how we each became interested in studying spiritual experiences. It seems only fair that our listeners have an opportunity to assess our motivation. After all, motivations make a difference in intellectual work, as in every other sphere of human life. Wesley. In August 1987, my partner Suzanne and I left Australia, flew from Sydney to San Francisco, and took up residence in Berkeley. I was pursuing a Ph.D. in philosophy of religion at the Graduate Theological Union, located on Holy Hill, along the north side of the University of California, Berkeley. We started out living in a beautiful apartment at Pacific School of Religion, nestled among the branches of ancient trees. It was like living in a treehouse, with squirrels staring at me through the windows while I tried to work. When I wasn't being eyeballed by squirrels, I was taking courses with John Searle and Hubert Dreyfus in UC Berkeley's philosophy department and studying modern Western religious thought with my advisor, Claude Welch, who had just retired as president and dean of the Graduate Theological Union. It was an amazing place and time. The weather was perfect, the intellectual environment was endlessly fascinating, and our living situation was fabulous. Even the earthquakes and fires were awe-inspiring. What better way for newly landed immigrants to figure out America? Though it took me a while to realize that Berkeley is a slightly misleading introduction to the United States, the town surely was a blast. It boasted affordable restaurants of every kind, people from every place, bookstores galore, and every variety of cultural activity. The view of San Francisco Bay from Holy Hill was breathtaking, a daily reminder of our great good fortune to be living there. Early in my second year at Berkeley, my friend and fellow student Kate McCarthy, now professor and dean of undergraduate education at Chico State University in Northern California, recruited me to work as a teaching assistant in a world religions class for undergraduates on the UC Berkeley campus. I had 3 years of coursework in religious studies from an earlier degree in Australia, so I felt ready. And here's the kicker. The course was to be taught by none other than the world-famous Houston Smith, guru to countless people and best-selling author of The World's Religions. Houston was the mainstay of the UC Berkeley Religious Studies teaching program, which he taught as an adjunct professor because the university had no religious studies department. I was eager to take on the challenge, so Kate soon introduced me to the grand old man. Thus began a beautiful and beautifully complex relationship. I functioned as a teaching assistant 3 times for Houston, twice in the World Religions Introduction and once in a class on mysticism and the so-called perennial philosophy, which was essentially about his spiritual worldview. Regardless of the class, Houston would be swept away as he described the wondrous worldview of the perennial philosophy, the great chain of being with its layers of meaning and intensity, stretching from inanimate matter, through plants and animals, through human beings with their souls, upward to realms of supernatural beings, including angels and demons and ghosts and jinns, and still further to God, and finally to the God beyond God, about which we can know and say nothing. I would behold Houston with rapt attention. He was a true believer. In parallel with those teaching adventures, and for some time after they ended, Houston met weekly through the academic year with Kate McCarthy and me, along with one other mutual friend, to discuss anything and everything. I was in and out of his and wife Kendra's home, constantly talking, intensely debating, grappling with big ideas, and beholding Houston's extraordinary mind. We'd debate what is really real, with Houston eloquently articulating the perennial philosophy's picture that things higher up on the great chain of being are more real than things lower down, and me arguing that more complexity and importance doesn't necessarily mean more intensity of being. We discussed the fate of the contemporary university, with Houston arguing that it was selling out to science, and me saying that the humanities were losing influence because they weren't making a good case for their value in the minds of scientists and ordinary citizens. We discussed the legalization of mescaline-rich peyote cactus button brew for the Native American church, which was an issue at the time. We'd roam over the world's religions, picking up resonances and dissonances, trying to come to grips with the near-universal cultural phenomenon of religion with its spiritual quests and supernatural worldviews. My goodness, what an education he gave me. The exciting weekly conversations within our little group went on for 3 years. I think Houston kept it up because he was fascinated with our intransigence. We just wouldn't be persuaded by his or any other version of the so-called perennial philosophy, which suggests that the central beliefs of all religions are literally true. Jesus really did rise from the dead. Gautama really did attain enlightenment under a Bodhi tree. Reincarnation is real. And their mutual contradictions reconciled within the great chain of being. According to Houston, every religion, every religious belief, and every religious practice takes shape within this multi-layered worldview, and mystical experience allows us to see it for ourselves. He wanted us to see the beautiful world he saw. We thought we could see his world just fine, but it struck us as too neat to be anything but an abstract fantasy version of the real thing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.